So my class of 24 kids had about 12 farmers' sons and daughters, and 12 of us had fathers with PhDs at Bell Labs. It was a really odd mix. And it didn't take a genius to notice how differently the two groups of kids were treated. And so by second grade, I had become aware, without any language for it at all, of a systematic degradation of the farmers' kids. Our second grade teacher really brought this home because she had a rule, which was every morning began with an inspection of our fingernails. You had to hold out your hands like this, and she walked up and down the aisles. And you had to present to her a white handkerchief. And I still carry one. She was that fearful. I don't know about my fingernails, though, but she was the wrath of God. And one day, she sent Arlene to the hall for the whole day because her fingernails were dirty. And I recall walking past the drinking fountain where Arlene was huddled, sneaking glances at us and people sneering at her twice because we went out for recess and came back, and there she was for 6 hours. And I remember asking the question to myself, how can she clean her fingernails out there? You know, how can she learn anything out there? It wasn't a moral question, it was a practical question. Because I didn't have a moral view on the matter at the time. But it incubated, that incident incubated, and 30 years later, I found myself, so to speak, metaphorically, in the hall. This was after 6 years of pell-mell administration for at Oberlin, as described, in the middle of nonstop revolution. I was burnt out after 4 years left, and suddenly I was a nobody, like Arlene. People who had seemed eager to have lunch with me would say, next time you're in town, perhaps. And so I felt that sense of uselessness and didn't want to stay in academia, probably could have, but something told me better to go out into the cold, freelance for a while. And I've never stopped freelancing, never signed up again in university life, but I do now make talks at them about a phenomenon that I observed at Oberlin prior to being nobodied. Some of you know Emily Dickinson's famous Nobody poem, I'm sure. I'll say it for you, it's so short, I think I can manage it. I'm nobody. Who are you? Are you a nobody too? Then there's a pair of us, don't tell. They'd banish us, you know. She nailed it with that word banish. That's how nobodies feel. They feel excluded, that they do not belong, that they've been banished. And they sulk and they seethe and they look for a chance to get even and usually don't find one. But every 50 years, they get together in enough numbers to find one. And then we have a movement. We have a black movement where nobodies finally got a critical mass of people that could not be ignored. The women's movement followed immediately. The gay movement followed too quickly for my good, because the first year I was at Oberlin, I was invited to a gay dance. And being a good old homophobe like everybody else, I was nervous by this, but I realized that as president, I either had to go or I would be, in effect, banishing this group. I would be, in effect, not doing for this group what I would do for other groups. So, with my wife displayed prominently on my arm, I went and survived and became a little less homophobic. But it was impossible not to be homophobic in those days. You see, I would have been insensitive had I not been, because everyone believed that. Even gays themselves were homophobic. Not all of them, but you know what I mean. No one had come to terms with this yet, and with the issue of sexual orientation. So my first year at Oberlin was just a parade of groups that held serious grievances, which made them ready to burn the place down, is what the 30 black students said to me, if you don't do something by Thanksgiving. And it was rhetorical, I'm sure, but it was nonetheless a serious threat. In fact, it was the reason I was in the job, because the previous president had thought that we already had done enough for blacks. We were willing to take anyone, regardless of color, if their board scores were 1600. So we were colorblind. We were not prejudiced. He could prove it with that statement. And there's a certain logic to that statement, but it didn't fly in 1970. It didn't appease the 30 black students who were on campus, 30 out of 3,000, that's 1%. They said, why not 10% like the country? I could go on and on about dealing with racism at Oberlin, but what I'm here to talk to you about today isn't any one of the isms. It was that after dealing with about six of them, and you know the names, but I'll say them one last time, racism, sexism, homophobia, ableism, ageism, which was a issue for the older faculty who were being forcibly retired at 65 and became nobodies the day after their birthday with no connection to the university. And there was probably one other ism that I'm forgetting, but you know, there were the Asian Americans, the Native Americans, everybody wanted their own identity group, and everybody had grievances. And my mind began to think, what do all these isms have in common? Do they have a wellspring from which they're all arising, like the heads on a hydra? I mean, could we? It reminded me of the situation with cancer, where there were a lot of named forms of cancer, like breast cancer, colon cancer, ovarian cancer, pancreatic cancer, prostate cancer, 10 more. And they all have underlying them a genetic malfunction. So they're all a genomic disease, really. And that's the way we're going to end up knocking them all off at once when we get down to that level of what went wrong at the genetic nanofactory level. And we're getting there. There are a lot of promising approaches at that level. I wondered about the isms in that same way. Is there some deeper source of human willingness to hold themselves superior to other people, for groups of humans to hold themselves superior to other groups whom they regard as not entirely human, or in any case, inferior humans. And I came to see that what was really going on here were various excuses for banishing and disadvantaging certain groups of people. The result of disadvantaging any group of people is to advantage the group that did it. You don't have as much competition. There were no women in physics or math at Oberlin. Less competition for the men. There were so few blacks that there was less competition to make the basketball team. It is to someone's advantage to disadvantage other people. And our ancestors noticed that 100,000 years ago and tried their best to enslave other tribes. The first form taken by what I now call rankism was slavery. And it's been practiced for 100,000 years, as long as hominids have been on the planet. And as soon as people discovered that it better than killing your foe was enslaving them and getting them to do your work. So there was a point in history where slavery represented advance over straight out murder. And slavery has continued in its full form up until 100 or so years ago all over the planet, and still continues in some places. There was just a Nobel Prize given in India to the man who is the champion of ending childhood slavery just last week. It's still a problem in various places, but it's a very big problem in other places where it has been tamed, so to speak. It's been glossied up and it takes the form of paying people so little that if they miss a single paycheck, they're homeless. That's a form of slavery too. That's the form we practice today. We can say it's because, oh, those people were inferior, they didn't work hard enough, or they weren't smart enough. But the truth is, if you look at it closely, it's much more likely that the reason they're in a low-paying job is they didn't have parents who had a high education. They themselves didn't complete their education. And had they had the advantages of the people who made it, they probably would have done statistically just as well. We don't differ from each other very much in intelligence, actually. We differ enormously from one another in our opportunities and in our background and in the education implicit in the models that our parents set for us. I wanted a word for the mother of all the isms, and I chose the word rankism because you can see racism as an example of rankism. It's the form of rankism wherein white people in this country see themselves as superior beings to people of dark people and manage to fabricate a consensus around that idea, enforced with the help of local law officials. And it takes all of that, and we've seen all of that dismantled in the last 50 or 60 years. Not entirely dismantled. There are still outbursts of racism. But it's taken a tremendous blow. It's basically in the doghouse. And the difference between then and now is not that racism is gone now. It isn't gone. But the difference is that people charged with it are on the defensive instead of the opposite. So we've shifted the burden of proof from the victims to the perpetrators. And that's a tremendous accomplishment. That's really 90% of the job, when you shift the burden of proof from the victims to the perpetrators, so that the person who we're likely to believe is the person who complains, not the person who says, oh, that was a lazy person or a stupid person, and therefore they deserve what they got. Rank in itself is not the culprit. Just like race is not the problem. Gender is not the problem. Vive la différence. For all those human differences. But rank can be abused, and then it's a very big problem. Then it's the source of indignity. It takes the form of humiliation, and it engenders blowback. Blowback from individual, from the victim to the perpetrator, and blowback from the country that feels dissed by a country that regards itself as superior and may in fact enjoy military superiority, but uses it out of a conviction that it deserves to, that it is superior. That's the biggest learning of the 20th century that I can see, is we really began to question the idea that any individual, any group, is inherently superior to any other group. This was a mainstay of colonialism, this assumption. You had to go out to Africa, if you were British, to save the savages, to educate them and bestow your benefits of your civilization on them. Meanwhile, you were stealing everything you could from their country. That's colonialism. That's an egregious form of rankism. There are many, many other forms, because rankism is abuse of the power inherent in rank. It's not rank. We have a perfect example that I've never had in any other talk I've given in the front row of four uniformed officers of various ranks. And I apologize for drawing attention to you, but I'm so glad you're here, because it makes the point about rank and its validity that's crucial to this whole argument. Without rank, there's disorder, there's crime. With rank, there's a lot less of it. When we endow certain people, when we entrust power to them, they have guns, we don't right now. We want it that way, because they're to protect us. Their rank is like the rank of a pilot flying the plane. We want the pilot to fly that plane, not the flight attendant. We want the chemistry professor to teach the course, not the person who cleans up the lab afterwards. These are different ranks, and they represent different degrees of knowledge. They're a measure of excellence, and we entrust to them a certain function without which society collapses, in your case. So rank is not the culprit, and it took me a long, long time to see that. I probably would have bought into the idea that Arlene, the second grader, partially deserved to be in the hall because her fingernails were dirty. This is what the main authority figure in the room was saying. I probably accepted it to some extent, but at least I had the question of how can she clean them out there? And so 30 years later, when I found myself out in the hall, so metaphorically, I began re-examining my whole experience at Oberlin and realized that we hadn't got to the nub of the matter, that we wouldn't really be able to deal with the familiarisms until we cut off the head of the hydra itself, until we drove a stake through the source of all the other isms. And that source, I felt, was abuse of the power inherent in rank. And rank itself, although it's often valid, and I've just given a few examples of valid rank, can sometimes be completely specious, but can serve a country, a community. The idea that British people were inherently superior to their African colonies was specious. The idea that heterosexuals are inherently superior to homosexuals was specious. We see all that now. So rank, social ranks especially, can be completely phony and specious and concocted to benefit a certain group. We have made great strides in validating all those specious examples of social rank. Now, any new social ranking comes along, we're suspicious of it. Because the idea has spread that there's some deep equality among human beings, regardless of any traits they bear, and that we should accord every single one of them equal dignity, even if they're in prison for serial murder. There's a dignity that should be accorded to those people. That doesn't mean they don't get punished. It just means it's done without blame. It's done with dignity. There's a prison in Virginia which has really taken this to heart, and it's called a dignitarian prison. And it's based on the ideas in somebodies and nobodies. And the wardens with whom I met and the prisoners with whom I spent a whole day behind bars treat each other with dignity unfailingly. When they're released, guess what the recidivism rate is compared to the average annual average recidivism rate in prisons in America today is 50%. In that prison, it's 5%. They learn how to handle indignities. So when one happens on the outside, they don't explode and commit a crime and go back into prison. That's how you, what you have to learn. You have to learn to absorb an indignity or two without having it trigger, blow your fuse, and finally deal with it in a dignified way. So that's what makes rankism so hard to combat, so much harder than the familiarisms, is because we're all victims of it, and we're all perpetrators of it as well. Because in different hierarchies, you see, you can be a nobody at home and a somebody at work, or vice versa. Or you can be, well, that's it. In different hierarchies, you may have quite different ranks, and you can end up abusing someone if you have a high enough rank and don't mind your manners and don't watch yourself. And even when we do watch ourselves, I mean, when I watch myself, having spent years defining defining rankism, I still catch myself occasionally perpetrating it, such as going into a bookstore, asking for a very well-known book, and the clerk has never heard of it, and a little raised eyebrow or sneer or some put down escapes my lips because, well, I was brought up that way. Just like I was brought up a homophobe and a racist and a sexist. Anyone my age was. The question isn't whether we were, the question is what are we doing about it? With the knowledge we now have, with the realization that these social ranks are specious, with the realization that many times rank is really just marks seniority and doesn't indicate excellence. This is a fundamental problem of the tenure system. It can give lifetime non-accountability to people. And wherever there's non-accountability, it only takes about 10 years for people to begin to self-aggrandize. So something has to be done, some tweak has to be made to the academic world to avoid situations, of which I know many, where you've got 80-year-olds who can't even do the problems of freshman year that they used to give students, and yet they're still pulling down the largest salaries in the university. We have to do something about that, just like we have to do something about abuses of rank in the civil service. We will do something about it once people recognize that it's unfair, that something will happen about it. But it will take committees agonizing for a decade, and then finally something will happen about it. Once it's labeled rankism, it makes it easier to tackle it. It makes it easier to see that it's a not so subtle sometimes, but often subtle form of discrimination. And it's no more justified than its familiar counterparts, the isms that are being brought to everyone's attention in Rise Above the Isms Week. It takes, I think, 6 or 7 generations to overcome an ism. And I can use my own family to show you what I mean. I happen to know my great-grandparents. They were bigots. They were nice people, but they were bigots. They would gleefully have joined a lynch mob. They lived in Duluth, Minnesota, where there was a very famous lynching in 23. I just hope they weren't involved with it, but who knows? They could have been. Their children, who were my grandparents, would never have joined a lynch mob. They were against that. But they used the N-word freely at home. I spent summers with them. My parents didn't use the N-word, and therefore my brothers and I didn't have to unlearn it. My parents, however, were prejudiced, but they had denied themselves the use of that slur. Accordingly, as I said, my brothers and I didn't have to unlearn it. My kids dated interracially. My grandchildren are interracial. That's 6 or 7 generations. And none of it's absolutely clear cut. The lines are blurred between them. But my my grandchildren are bored with Martin Luther King Day. And that's a good thing. That means they don't need it. They don't know what you're even talking about. All their friends, it's a urban environment, are from every country you ever heard of, are playing in this park, and they regard it as redundant to tell them that they shouldn't be prejudiced against these kids who look a little different. So that means we're making progress. But rankism hasn't really been touched as such. Examples of it, heads have been cut off the Hydra, but the Hydra keeps growing new ones. And until we address rankism in all its forms, and there are many, many forms, and they're spelled out in my various writings and blog posts and books, until they're identified and talked about for 10 years, we won't have begun to disallow them. The university, unfortunately, is not without its rankism. It's an elitist institution, and sometimes that takes the form of snobbery, of superiority, and of downright self-aggrandizement in the form of jobs that are unaccountable. So all these things have to be addressed, Blame is not warranted. We've all grown up with these institutions, and we're all complicit in them. But noticing them is worth doing, and because it's not because it's nice to do that. It's much deeper than that. It's because it makes for a much more efficient and creative and productive group when dignity is secure within that group. A few famous companies in California have learned that. They practice dignitarian practices all the time. They treat the person who cleans this rug at midnight the same way they treat the Nobel Prize winner. And they are famous brand names that you have in your pocket right now. And these places are enormously creative and productive and have happy employees. That's going to win out. Dignity actually turns out to work. And that's really, if it didn't, none of this would matter a bit. This would all just be nice talk that would be ignored the next day. But dignity turns out to work. Diversity works too. They work together and they make for a more productive and creative organization. And the companies that practice it make more money. If they didn't, it wouldn't. But they do, it turns out. They have cash reserves of $200 billion. Well, this is just anecdotal, this part of it, of course. But the case can be made, and it has to be made, that dignity works or dignity is doomed. I've seen a steady march towards enlarging the circle of dignity over my lifetime. Every ism that's been combated has been dented, if not overcome. And rankism itself remains to be taken on per se, and when we do, we'll create classrooms in which the kids don't spend half their energy shielding their dignity, fearful that they're going to be told that they're stupid or dirty or excluded from a club. There's a wonderful book out called about kindergartens called You Can't Say, You Can't Play. That's the title of the book. In that kindergarten, no one can say the words, you can't play. And I'm going to a high school in Brooklyn tomorrow and talking to hundreds of kids there about creating a dignitarian culture in their high school. High schools are beginning, in the name of combating bullying, which is a very obvious form of rankism, they are creating dignity curricula, in which they examine the ways they treat each other and the way teachers treat the students and build a culture where dignity is secure within which they can learn.